It is an ominous world out there lately. There's plenty to worry about, plenty to make us nervous and anxious. It used to be easy to say, do not be afraid, because we did not have so much to make us so nervous, especially those among us who are European Americans, those of us who are Anglos, those of us who are white. And even for us, I, for one, had the illusion that when a victory was won, it would stay won. An end to legal segregation? Great. But hey, there are still places where people of color cannot get a mortgage, areas that are redlined. Or there are places where you can get an apartment, but if your family's from India, you can get shot dead over a parking spot by a white guy who thinks you're not quite American enough. Not for real. You know, like the French people in Paris in 1940 thought that French Jews weren't quite French enough. And the cause of violence doesn't even have to be anything about anything in the United States. There was a shooting at a PCUSA church last week that I mentioned, where a Chinese American from Vegas drove to a Presbyterian church in Orange County, California. The church was predominantly Taiwanese. And the shooter thought that they were wrong because Taiwan was not part of China. It is a renegade province, in the words of the Chinese government. So while he harbored the viewpoints of his home country, he took action like an American and expressed his anger with a gun. It wasn't anything that the church was doing. It was just who the people are. And that is cold comfort to us if we are worried about someone coming here because they get angry about our flags or something we stand for. The session met on Tuesday, and this subject was brought up out of a legitimate concern for our administrator, Jessica, because she answers the phone and is the point of contact for anyone coming through the door. Jessica says she's had a couple of calls from people asking questions about our flags, and one angry call, which she was concerned about enough to lock the door, but she doesn't seem to be worried about it. She logs calls like that, and if she's worried, she said she would call the police. Well, we have a new policy now. A, if she gets a call like that, she gives it to me. If I'm not there, she takes the name and number and I call back. B, any calls of concern, we report to the police department right away. They would rather have us do that than wait. And C, we have to recognize that in today's America, anyone is in danger anywhere. And it's not so bad for us as it is for Black people who face this every day. In my report to the session, I talked about this. The recent spate of shootings is giving people cause for concern about the safety of our congregation in a nation that is full of people with guns. A member of session raised the issue as a matter of concern, and it is a legitimate concern, one that we need to take into account. We know that this community has plenty of very conservative people, but I'm not worried about them. I'm worried about the fringe crackpot people that are everywhere in the United States. The fact that we advocate for racial justice, for the rights of the LGBTQIA plus community, and now for a woman's right to choose, means that there will be people who disagree with us. The question is, will they think we are just wrong, or will they think we are minions of Satan that need to be expunged? We've talked about this at the seminary, because it seemed that a lot of our heroes were pastors and spiritual people who got shot. And there is a sliding scale between what pastors believe and what they are empowered to say by their congregation. In the civil rights era, pastors could get fired by a congregation that does not want them to speak up on behalf of minorities. We watched a video about that in Adult Ed, about a Lutheran church in Omaha that did just that in 1962. In our situation, this congregation and I see eye to eye about what needs to be addressed. Early on, I had two members who quit over flags, one because I removed the flag from the chancel, and one because we installed a rainbow flag out front. I'm okay with that. New pastors tend to lose about 10% of any congregation when they start. Plus, congregations have to focus their message. And sometimes that means saying no. Those two people would be better off elsewhere, and so would we. We'd rather be a gathering place for people who are officially tolerant and justice-oriented rather than try to be all things to all people. When we first put up our flags, we think they were stolen maybe even twice, but replacing them immediately removed the satisfaction of trying to silence us. However, the threat of gun violence is a national problem, and every pastor knows that if they are preaching something that a crackpot gun nut gets angry about, they know where to find us. Bishop Oscar Romero is one of my Catholic heroes. He was in El Salvador, and when the government started killing poor people, he would read the names of the victims from the pulpit. The government told him not to. He kept doing it, so they sent in two goons with machine guns and shot him in his own pulpit. And frankly, that's the gig. I honestly don't think I'm in any danger, and I don't think the congregation has any greater risk coming here than we do going to the grocery store or a baseball game. And the fact is, 50 people got killed watching a concert in Las Vegas because a crackpot with a bunch of guns started shooting at them from a hotel window. That's the landscape we are in. We can be shot for no reason at all. Beyond that, I'm not going to avoid saying anything that needs to be said because someone might get mad at me. I've said it before, and my wife has come to terms with it. And as the congregation, you need to know that this is what we are doing here. I don't think it is any secret, but maybe we need to reflect for a moment on how dangerous the world actually is. Someone might decide to burn our church down or come in here with a machine gun. But that could happen at the grocery store. Black people take that risk every day in the United States, so I don't think there's anything particularly brave about being white Protestants advocating for social justice issues in a suburban church. The guy who shot up the Tops grocery store in Buffalo was looking for a place where he could do the most damage to the Black community. He had a military-grade weapon he bought legally at the age of 18. Even though he was under examination for mental illness. He illegally modified it to hold more ammo. He bought body armor, cased the joint, and then unleashed mayhem at a grocery store. I also know that the state of affairs might make some people nervous about coming to church. For them, I would acknowledge that anxiety is a real thing. And if your anxiety is becoming a problem for you, it is perfectly okay to stay at home and watch online for a while. There's nothing wrong with that. That's a legitimate decision. But for the rest of us, this is what we are called to do, to not be afraid, to speak truth to power. And if someone decides to kill us, that is on them. It can't change how we operate, or we might as well just hang it up. We're not going to just put a hat pin through our frontal lobe and pretend that nothing is at stake. We've been talking about real issues that are life and death matters. That is what we do. And we are not going to live in fear. The gunman in Buffalo killed 10 normal Americans buying food because he was sold a line from Tucker Carlson, among others, who bandy about an idea called the Great Replacement. Carlson spells it out like this, that Democrats are encouraging immigration of non-white people, which he says are more malleable and more controllable, to replace the legacy voters, i.e. white voters. And he creates a climate of fear because fear drives ratings. Carlson has promoted this crackpot conspiracy theory over 400 times on the air, and 50 plus people have died because of it. Carlson's show is the most profitable on Fox News, which earns a cool $1 billion a year in profits for Rupert Murdoch, because they don't spend money on journalism. They just let a crackpot say whatever drives people to fear. The idea is laughable on its face. but do not laugh. This paranoid fantasy killed 9 Black worshipers at Emmanuel AME Church in Charleston, South Carolina. AME means American African Methodist Episcopal. That was in Charleston in 2015. It killed 11 Jewish worshipers in the Tree of Life Synagogue in Pittsburgh, 2018. They were involved in immigrant settlements because they were a congregation of immigrants. It killed 23 people, mostly Latinos, at a Walmart in El Paso in 2019. And now we have the carnage of 10 more Black people in Buffalo. So a Black church, a Jewish synagogue, a Walmart, and a Black grocery store. Just to underline how crazy this is, immigrants are just as likely to vote Republican as they are Democratic. But that's not the point. The point is to encourage viewers to feel humiliated, afraid of being muscled out, pointing out people who are different than they are, to make them other instead of fellow Americans. And they are preaching a gospel of fear. I'm told that there are really only 2 emotions, fear and love. And if indeed that is the case, then we know which side we have to come down on. And there are a lot of churches, especially our siblings at evangelical churches, that preach the gospel of fear. We are to fear the poor. We are to fear the LGBTQIA. We are to fear homeless people. We are to fear women having their own rights to make their own decisions. We are to fear immigrants and people of color. Here's how ridiculous this is. In New Mexico, I might have told this story before, but it's a good one. In New Mexico, a woman was talking on her phone. She had very tan skin. She looked like a Native American, or she might have been a Mexican. A white woman thought she was speaking in Spanish and started to berate her. She said, "In this country, we have always spoken English. So if you're not going to speak English, you should go back to wherever you came from." And the tan woman on the phone said, "I was speaking in Navajo. And in this country, we've been speaking Navajo for 40,000 years. And if you're not going to speak Navajo, then you should go back to England." So now the choice is ours, and it is a matter of spiritual practice. We have 2 stories from the Bible today, and they tell us what it means to be disciples of the faith. We are disciples if we practice our faith with some discipline, and we can all do a little better job of that. That's why we try to come here every week, to keep on track, to give the Holy Spirit a chance to work on us. Jesus doesn't ask us to believe something. He asks us to do something. We are known by our fruit. We are known by what we actually do. Let's take a look at Acts, chapter 16, verse 13. "On the Sabbath day, we went outside the gate by the river, where we supposed that there was a place of prayer. And we sat down and spoke to the women who had gathered there," end quote. Women had gathered by the river as a place of prayer. In those days, a traditional role for women was to get the water while the men would farm or tend a flock or go hunt. They would also wash the clothes. So these women were gathered at the workplace to pursue the spiritual practice of praying together with each other. Verse 14, "A certain woman named Lydia, a worshiper of God," that means Jewish, "was listening to us. She was from the city of Thyatira and a dealer in purple cloth." Now, that means she was very wealthy. Purple cloth was only available to royalty. It was very rare, very expensive. It was strictly regulated, and you had to be pretty sharp to be given that franchise. The Lord opened her heart to listen eagerly to what was being said by Paul. She was inspired by his teaching. She was a prayerful person, a worshiper of God, and Paul was a Pharisee, speaking about Jesus, and it struck a deep chord within her. Verse 15, "When she and her household were baptized," okay, that meant she was in charge. If she got baptized, then they would all get baptized. The same way a European prince, if he became Lutheran, then his whole kingdom became Lutheran. She urged us, saying, "If you have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come and stay at my home." And she prevailed upon us, end quote. She extended to them the spiritual practice of hospitality. She invited them to stay in her home. She supported the work of the prayers and the teachers and disciples. It was ever thus that women with money supported the itinerant work of Jesus and his disciples. Women were essential to the formation of the early church. Essential to the formation of the early church. So, what was practiced here? Praying, teaching, learning, and supporting the community of faith. Now let's go to the reading from John. Jesus said, "But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not let them be afraid." What spiritual practice is happening here? That we be open to the Spirit, that we accept the peace that Jesus gives us, that we do not allow our hearts to be troubled, that we do not live in fear because we have faith in God. Jesus gives us peace, not as the world gives it to us, because that would not last, but as God gives peace to us, a spiritual peace, an inner peace, a peace beyond our own understanding, a peace that seems too good to be true, one that is so unreal it can only be approached by having faith that it will be there. And that is why, that is what we mean when we say, "Peace be with you." It means fear not. Do not be afraid. Let us pray. Dear God, we long for peace on earth. We long for a day when people will treat each other with love and respect, or at least respect as a form of love, instead of fear as a form of hate. Bless us with peace and the spiritual discipline to live out that peace as we go through our lives in this world. All this we ask in your name. Amen.